Tonight's show is a delicate little flower that's blossoming into maturity. First, we'll get verbally abused by Triumph the Insult Comic Dog, and then I'll take out the anger on our crew. Plus, Jim Rose, the talented and twisted ringleader of the freak show revival, the Jim Rose Circus, will show us some freaks and then make us feel bad for calling them that. And finally, ultraviolet star Mila Jovovich is here. She's going to fully explain to us the concept of genetically engineered warriors from the future. That's right. But now it's time for the program that's unsure of what's happening to its body. It's Attack of the Show!
Pick up on this.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to Attack of the Show. It's okay. It's okay to be excited. It's all right. Don't worry about it.
Oh.
Yeah, right?
All of a sudden.
No, I'm over this. Whatever, let's just get it done. Go to commercial. Have a cigarette. No, there's really exciting stuff. Got a great show today.
We do.
Guests coming up. But this is something that I got very excited about last night, and I wanted to talk to you and the folks at home about it, if you don't
mind. Let's hear it, Kev.
Well, Waxy is a blog that we like. We go there a lot. And Waxy just picked up on a post from the Something Awful forums about a buried video game treasure. It's an unreleased Penn and Teller game for the Sega CD, yeah.
So this is something that even gamers may never have seen or heard of.
Most of them haven't,
like,
yeah. The company went under, and someone from, I believe, Lost Levels got a disc, and they posted a whole review, and they released the game online. It looks like a standard side-scroller, I know that, but it's extremely weird, as you'd probably expect from Penn and Teller. You collect cockroaches to sell to movie producers for cash.
Is that some sort of a statement about Hollywood?
It's got to be somewhere in there. And every store clerk in the game is played by Debbie Harry from Blondie.
Okay.
So,
I mean,
getting better.
It could be worse.
You can even hire stunt doubles who actually look nothing like you. They have bright blonde hair, and they're, like, thin, and they jump, and they do tumbles and kung fu kicks. But when they're done fighting for you, you have to sit through a two-minute unskippable movie of Penn and Teller eating pizza.
Wow.
I love it. I so wish it was out. It gets better, I promise.
It does?
One more thing I have to tell you about. I was so excited when I read this. The game has a great mini game. It's called Desert Bus. And you drive a bus from Tucson to Las Vegas in real time.
In real lifetime?
Yeah.
Like it took all day?
It's going to take you 8 hours to complete this game.
And you pass through tumbleweed
desert.
And...
desert. It gets better. The bus will not go over 45 miles an hour, and it veers slightly to the right, so you can't just, like, tape the controller down.
Oh,
you actually have to drive it. There's no other cars on the road. There's bus stops where you stop, you'll open the doors, and no one will get on. And you 8 hours to get to your spot, you get 1 point, and then they want you to drive it all the way back for another point.
Curiously enough, it kind of sounds like something I'd want to do.
Totally. You pass the old water pipe around and sit down and drive the bus.
I don't understand that.
Brilliant.
Water pipe.
We're going to have links to the torrent on our website. Go download it. Run a Sega CD emulator if you have to. It's awesome.
You know, Kevin, you know what's also cool? Newsvine. This is a user-created news site that was officially launched today. Take a look at this. It's basically an online news site that you build yourself. You handpick stories from other news feeds. You can also comment on the stories. You can also chat with users about the news, about the stories. You can write your own articles, sort of like your own journalism, you know, exercise, and add to your own personal page. And if people start linking to the stories that you write, if you start getting popular because you're good, you're going to get paid for it,
yeah.
Which is really cool.
Yeah, it's a good thing for, really good thing for grassroots journalism. Like, anybody can get it up there and start getting the money.
Hey, I mean, I'd like to give it a try and
sure.
See if I got good, and if I get good, I get some money. What do you have to lose? Payments actually aren't going to start until the site launches advertising, but right now, it's clean, it's easy to use, it's free news. And you can, you know, let you work on your existing blog.
It's really good stuff. Newsvine.com.
Newsvine.
Everybody check it out. One final thing that you might want to bookmark, folks. IDW Publishing, which puts out all the Transformers comic books. They've posted some really sweet concept art for a new set. It's a new Transformers set. Basically, the time period is the Industrial Revolution.
Okay.
So Optimus Prime is sort of reimagined as a steam locomotive.
Aww.
That's pretty sweet.
I like that.
Megatron turns into a giant artillery cannon.
Scary.
Right?
Yeah.
And a fellow robot to gun Decepticon, Shockwave, will now turn into an ironclad battleship. So
you sunk my battleship.
We just had to throw it out there. The series is going to debut in June with the four-part Hearts of Steel series. It's pretty sweet stuff. I know we got a lot of Transformers fans out there.
Who thought Transformers would last as long as it did?
I mean,
it is going strong.
Yeah, and it's gaining steam. Gaining steam. Guess what, folks? We are taking your chat, and I ain't taking any lip.
Oh.
So hurry up and email us through our web form at attackoftheshow.com/ Ask Us, and you can chat with us in our IRC chat room at chat.g4tv.com. Do it now, or Sarah will sob uncontrollably. No, it's okay. They're going to do it, Sarah. They're going to do it.
Sure.
Yeah, I'm sure. You should cry, though, because it's kind of hot. Coming up after the break, ultraviolet star Mila Jovovich classes up our couch. But first, Triumph the Insult Comic Dog treats me with all the love and respect he would a fire hydrant.
Attack of the show, baby. Attack. Attack of the show, attack.
And now, here to shamelessly hump your leg about his upcoming G4 special live via satellite from Central Park, deep in the heart of New York City, it's Triumph, the Insult Comic Dog.
Yes.
Triumph, are you there, buddy?
Yes, hello, yes,
can
he, I'm
can
here.
Can you hear me, Triumph?
Yes, let's get it over with.
All right, Triumph.
Yes.
Tell me, why did you choose G4 as the network to show off your stuff?
A lot of people have been wondering why I chose to put all my best material on the G4 network. Actually, public access was booked.
Oh, come on, Triumph.
Sorry, I'm a little nervous talking to Kevin Pereira. I mean, you're like the biggest star on G4. Seriously. That's like being the biggest flea on my left nut.
Yeah, Triumph, thanks. It's actually an honor to be anywhere near your sack, I must say.
Yeah, you're not going to get any closer to my sack. Trust me.
That's fine. I'll stay at arm's length. Triumph, I have to ask you, though, honestly, I'm a little concerned. You know, a best of already? Are you simply just out of new ideas and really just trying to cash in on everything?
I'm not getting a dime from this. I'm doing it purely out of charity to the gamers who watch G4. By the way, don't you think the name G4 is a little vague? Why don't call it something, you know, more specific to the target audience, like Acne Planet or Childhood Obesity Central?
That's a fantastic idea, Triumph. I'll run that by
Kevin,
the old higher-ups
here. Do any women watch this network, Kevin? Okay, let me rephrase that. Do any women under 165 pounds watch this network?
No. Actually, not to my knowledge, no. But let's move on, Triumph.
Right.
Now that your show
good.
Is on G4, I have to wonder, can we actually get you as a guest here in our studio?
Absolutely not. Absolutely not. I have my limits. This is the closest you'll ever come to talking to me.
All right. Well, have you ever seen Attack of the Show?
I love Attack of the Show. I don't know how you pull it off. How do you do it? How do you target to an audience whose only sexual encounter is banging a hooker in Grand Theft Auto?
That's a fantastic question,
Triumph. Kevin, I want you to meet the typical G4 viewer.
All
Bring
right.
him in.
Sure thing, Triumph.
This is my target audience. This is G4 viewers. Be careful. Put down the toys, G4 viewers, because this is your future. This is what you're going to look like in 20 years.
Oh, believe him not, goodly gentles. For those of you who don't know, Black Wolf the Dragon Master at your service.
You like him? You know this guy, Kevin?
Yes, Triumph. Of course, I know exactly who he is.
Go ahead, Black Wolf. Tell him about yourself.
Yes. New York's unofficial wizard. My job? To look after all the good dragons of the multiverse and to encourage my fellow New Yorkers to imagine responsibly.
Nice, isn't it? I haven't seen him this excited since he changed the valve on his girlfriend.
All right, this is great, actually, that he's here now. Triumph, if you don't mind, I have a question for Black Wolf, if
Kevin
I can.
Kevin has a question for Black Wolf.
What would
I'll relay
thou know, sir,
I'll
Kevin?
Relay the question.
Thank you. That's very kind of you. Black Wolf, I'm wondering, are you a fan of Attack of the Show?
Are you a fan of Attack of the Show?
Oh, I think it's a wonderful series. I wish I could tune in every other week.
There you go. A perfectly cogent answer.
Fantastic. Are you guys still in... I have to ask, Black Wolf, are you still enjoying that fillet of fish there?
Are you still enjoying the fillet of fish?
You folks will not let the fillet of fish thing go, will you?
It was a McChicken and not a fillet of fish. Not such a nerd now, is he?
Right, because poultry makes all the difference. Right, Black Wolf? Yeah. Yeah, thanks for joining us, Triumph and Black
Thank
Wolf.
You.
We appreciate it, guys.
It's a great network. For me to poop on!
All right, folks, there you have it. Be sure to catch Triumph Special right here on the old G4 on Sunday, March 5th at 11 p.m. Now, According to my research, our gambling guru, Jimmy the Geek, is up next. And the Lush does unspeakable things in exchange for beads down at Mardi Gras. Just stick around. You'll see what I'm talking about. And now a man who eats beer nuts for breakfast and chugs whiskey for dinner. Yeah, Brendan Moran.
Contrary to what most people believe, Kevin, Mardi Gras isn't just about beads and boobs. It's about community. It's about culture. It's about getting plastered and waking up in a pool of your own urine. In other words, the perfect place for the Lush.
Mardi Gras 2006. I'm here in New Orleans, right outside of Ted O'Brien's. It's a bar famous for making the hurricane. We're doing the Lush here, and for once, I'm gonna get to see other people get f***ed up. What's your name?
Ted O'Brien's has been in business since 1933. We actually opened down the street a block from here. In 1942, we moved to this location.
We've been around for 73 years now. We're right in the middle of our Mardi Gras season. It's post-Katrina, but the crowds are good, and you know, people are coming back in the city. It's a fun time like it is usually every year.
At Pat O'Brien's specialty is, of course, the Pat O'Brien's Hurricane, which we developed in the mid-40s. At that time in the country, the war was going on. There wasn't that much whiskey to be purchased. In order for a bar owner to be able to buy, like, one case of whiskey, the liquor salesman would force them to buy like 50 cases of rum. So they just started kind of mixing and matching and came up with this passion fruit flavor that that is still our hurricane today. Now the hurricane is pretty much synonymous with New Orleans, and that's fine. We still claim fame to being the original home of the hurricane.
What are you drinking? Hurricane.
You can't see this at home, but he just drank 15 ounces of hard liquor. So now you're from New Orleans, you probably don't partake in the traditional New Orleans kind of thing, you know, that girls do to get beads. We're doing an interview here, pal. You know what I mean?
Not at all, but they are right there.
Who's doing that? Are there girls taking their shit? Nice meeting you. What are you wearing?
I'm wearing Prada and a penis.
That's about the size of mine.
We have different bars, and we always have. We have a main bar, we have a piano lounge, and as you keep on walking, you come into our huge patio.
What do you think about Pat O'Brien's?
First time I've been here. I just got here. I'm about to go get a drink, though.
Am I keeping you from that?
Yeah, man.
No one walks away from me. Danielle, you're clearly 14 years old.
I'm 23.
Okay.
Whatever you want to say, I'll look at your driver's license later. Well, we sure have learned a lot this week. Actually, we haven't learned anything really, but it's all been fun. Tune in next time for another segment of The Lush.
Must have been a little frustrating watching all those other people drink and enjoy Mardi Gras when you yourself didn't get to pound
it. Kevin,
right?
I am a professional.
Right.
You know,
How often I forget.
I have a job to do there, and then only after that job is finished can I, you know, relax. And that may mean imbibing one or two or nine hurricanes, but, you know.
Okay. So you did enjoy a tasty beverage. That's good.
Yeah.
Good. I'm glad to hear. Good report, Brendan.
Yeah.
I like that. Apparently that wraps up our Mardi Gras coverage, everybody.
Say.
It's done.
Yes. Kevin, now, this time of year, the sports calendar's thinner than Nicole Richie after a bout of dysentery. But that hasn't stopped the resident odds maker from putting his handicapping talents to use. Joining us live from Hollywood with his picks for this weekend's Academy Awards, it's Jimmy the Geek. Jimmy, how are you, my friend?
Break out the fake breath and pour me a latte. I'm in Hollywood, baby.
That you are. I see you've gone with the old tux for the occasion.
That's right, Brandy. The last time I saw this jacket, my prom date was using it as a headrest in the backseat of my Chevelle. I'm talking about memories, baby.
I'll bet. Jimmy, I thought you'd be a little closer to the Kodak Theater for tonight's segment, though.
Yeah, you know what? Me too, Brandy. Turns out getting access to the red carpet area is tougher than trying to pleasure a freaking bobcat.
Gonna have to take your word on that one. Jimmy, what do you got for us?
All right, let's talk Oscars, baby. Kicking things off with the easy stuff first. Billy Hoffman winning Best Actor in a complete cakewalk. He nailed Capote like I nailed that wannabe actress last night with complete and total ease. I mean, I don't even look like Ang Lee, and she still bought it. Speaking of which, put a C note on him to win Best Director. If it were gay cowgirls instead of cowboys, I'd put it on my all-time top five, baby. And Clooney upsets Giamatti for Best Supporting. The Academy rewards him for his body of work this year and tells the more deserving G-Man to go F himself.
Jimmy, as always, telling it like it is. What else?
All right, let's talk women now, baby. Best Actress is a tough call. The chick who does her own singing versus the gender bender. It's a complete toss-up, Brandy. And when that happens, I go with the one I want to bang more. Now it's all of a sudden, it's completely easy. Reese Witherspoon, and that's a lock on both counts, baby.
Reese and a lock. Moving on.
All right. It doesn't get any easier, Brandy, than Best Supporting. It's a three-horse race. And if I were a jockey, I'd bring the whip down hard on Rachel Weisz in the backstretch. Look for the Academy to do the same. She wins this one by a nose.
Bringing it back to a sports analogy, I hope. How about Best Picture, Jimmy?
All right, Brandy. With Lee already holding gold, there's no need to reward a bunch of kids for playing cowboy here. Crash has the script, the cast, and Matt Dillon saving someone from burning alive, though for my money, to be honest, the first time he did it on screen was a bit more memorable, babe.
Jimmy, you have done it again, my friend. A full Oscar rundown and a nod to the Outsiders, if I'm not mistaken.
Stay gold, baby. Stay gold.
That's Jimmy the Geek, live from Hollywood, California. Stick around. We have a satchel full of news on the way. We call it the feed. And we'll have Jim Rose of Jim Rose Circus fame and a special performance by BB the Circus Queen next. Welcome back to the liveliest show on television. Coming up, you'll require UV protection when ultraviolet star Mila Jovovich unleashes her fury on our set. And then I break out the white man's overbite because it's Live Music Thursday presented by Dentine Ice, and Cage 9 is here. And yes, folks, what you've heard is true. They are, in fact, ready to rock. Now, the Jim Rose Circus has been entertaining and horrifying audiences all over the world for more than 15 years. And if you don't know exactly what the circus is all about, here's a little taste.
Attention, ladies, ladies. Attention, do not try this at home. Oh! Don't rip them out, Lipto! Don't rip them out! We need you tomorrow night! It hurts so good!
Ouch, Jim, welcome to the show. It's an honor to have you here, my friend. I gotta say, looking at the circus, it wasn't quite a compact car packed with clowns. Not your deal?
No.
Elephants and cotton candy?
You take the makeup off of a clown and all you get's an old pervert.
Sure, but you drive a nail through his nose and now you got a show.
And now you've got a,
What are some of the featured acts for the Jim Rose Circus?
Well, you know, we've switched a lot since that video you just showed. We've now got Mexican transvestite wrestling.
Love it.
Women's sumo wrestling.
Great.
We're doing Battle of the Sexes.
This sounds like every CD show I can see in back alley in Mexico, but you guys are touring it across the
country. My entire backyard is brought and put on stage.
I love it.
We've got Loblo Ventura, Trailer Trash Guerrero, Tickles Valdez, Billy Martinez, the Barrio Bottom. Those are our Mexican transvestite wrestlers.
And so do they just come on stage and they perform like a cage match, or is there a mud wrestling, or are they doing parlor tricks?
What's they wear sexual aids. Can you say dildo?
Well, we just did. I mean, let's go ahead.
And the first one that can force it into the other one's mouth for a 1-2-3 count wins.
Now, that is a tag team match I'd like to see, actually, on WWE.
So. No chickens at that cockfight.
Okay.
All the action takes place below the belt. Then we've also got the women's sumo wrestling, Judy the Bull Moose Jenkins, Katie the Pile Driver Wilson, Large Marge, Gale Force, and tipping the scale at a dainty 500 pounds, Tundra.
Very nice.
Yeah, she needs a goal, so she calls herself Tundra. And then the battle of the sexes, Kevin, I think you'd get a real kick out of it. I've seen so many people try to do their version of Battle of the Sexes, but we wanted to get right down to the essence of what it is. So we've got the amazing Mr. Liftoff, the guy you just saw with the knipples.
Sure.
He attaches one end of a chain to the part of him that's most a mister.
Okay.
The other part of that chain is attached to a porn star we have in our show by the name of Amber Pye, and she attaches that to her labia. They have a tug of war.
Very nice.
So that is truly the battle of the sexes.
That is.
Then we throw out hundreds of condoms into the audience. Whoever gets the blue one gets a half an hour with our porn star in private after the show.
So it's really take the kids. This is a family show, you're saying.
Yeah. sex can be art, and she's going to prove that we're just using crayons.
We have a clip, actually, of Matt the Tube Crowley.
Oh, yeah.
What is this trick that we're about to see that Matt's performing here?
Some people end up in the hospital, and they're unable to eat. Mm-hmm. And this is how you force feed those in a hospital unable to eat. It's called gavage.
Okay. And so this is you. This looks like something Little Kim, I think, got in trouble for. There's a tube going into him here. And what is that you're filling up with the tube there?
I think we're dumping beer in there.
Oh,
right,
good.
Now.
Good little malt liquor for the show.
Yeah. It's that aftertaste you got to worry about.
So this is going into his body. And what is he going to do with this once it's been ingested?
Well, then we're
going to
pump it back out.
Okay.
And that should make it body temperature. And, you know, some people like it room temperature. He likes it body temperature.
Of course.
And there you go. Cheers. And then people come up from the audience.
All right.
And drink it.
Little audience participation there.
Yeah. At first it tastes like crap.
Right. And then it tastes like Coors.
After you wish it was. Yeah. Right.
You've been doing this for, like I said, over 15 years now. Is it harder to shock audiences? Have they seen it all? You know, beer and bile? Great. I did that at a kegger last week.
Yeah.
I'm over it.
I hear you. Well, you know, I thought so. And then we took out Battle of the Sexes, and the crowds were just as big as ever. And by the way, we've been keeping the total on that, Kevin, and the female genitalia is winning 163 to the male appendage.
Sure.
The male appendage comes in at about 80 something. So
wow.
Are
they trying to get a flag over a line, or is whatever part rips first?
That has happened also.
Oh, man, that's a show.
To Mr. Lifto. They took skin from his bum, they grafted it to his. You know,
his area, his member.
Now he says when he scratches his ass, he gets an erection.
That's phenomenal. For more reasons than one, I'm assuming.
Yeah.
I want to talk about your book real quick.
Thanks.
Because this is great. Snake Oil. You reveal the secrets of the magicians, the hustlers, the con artists, the carnies. They're all one and the same.
Yeah.
Are you upset that you're giving away all the secrets? Are you glad that people finally have the knowledge? That they're armed with it?
I wrote that so that you could be dropped off in any city, anywhere in the world, not be able to speak the language. Mm-hmm. And make money immediately. It shows you how to hustle. Everybody talks about a street education. That guy's got street smarts. Well, you got to go through a lot of dues, and it's painful to get that kind of education. Now you don't have to go through that process. You just pick up the book Snake Oil, and you'll know what it all means.
I agree. I love it. It's a great read from front to back.
And you were
it's
telling
so,
me
it's
that earlier.
Pick up. It really is. I'm not. I don't BS. I don't do it. Now, I made a joke about a family show earlier, but this is a bit of a family show for you. You have your wife involved as well, and she's standing over there with some sort of interesting apparatus. She's going to give us a special performance.
Yeah, we're going to do a freestyle freak. Let's come on over here.
So this
Kevin.
Is Bebe the Circus Queen standing.
Yeah, that's
with,
my wife.
Okay,
that's my wife.
How you doing, Bebe?
And
this looks.
What I'm going to do?
Inviting.
Yeah, I'm gonna suck the air out of this with a. Hey, actually, get down there, Kevin. Get in here.
No, actually, I think we're good, Jim. This looks great.
I know you're supposed to rehearse this stuff ahead of time, but I'll make sure that get in. Just get in.
Okay. What is gonna happen here?
I should have told the producer, but whatever.
This is great.
Are you sure?
This is we're not. Oh no.
Now sit down in there, Kevin.
No,
get in there.
Vacuum packing is something you do to like turkey after Thanksgiving.
Yeah, I know,
not to
man. You're gonna be a freeze dried freak when I'm through with you.
This is safe, right, Bebe?
I tell you what, I wouldn't call it safe. As a matter of fact, this is a good opportunity to say, don't try this at home.
Okay, don't try this live on television. How about that?
With Kevin.
Bebe, a pleasure to meet you, by the way.
Yeah,
it's Mitchum. Just so you know, last 2 days.
Oh yeah.
All right. Jim, what's going to happen now?
Well, I'm going to start sucking the air out of this.
Okay. Yes, he is.
And I'm going to see how long you can stay in there, see if I can suck the brains out of your ears. We're going to turn blue for you, G4. Blue for you. How long can Kevin stay in there? I think he's turning into a lesbian. 5, 4, 13, 13, 13. I've lost count. How long can he stay in there? How long? All right, I'll let you.
I'll let you out. Are you all right? You okay? Is he all right? Hey, Kev.
Yeah, hey, what's up, dude? Yeah. Woo! I found Jesus. Thank you for that.
Hey, dude.
He was in there.
It is, dude, right?
Jim, yeah.
You wow. said my wife looks like Jesus, huh?
Yeah, she did. BB, thank you for that. That was great.
Nice to meet you.
Jim, I'm now officially afraid of you, my friend. Thank you.
You're officially in the Jim Rose Circus.
Everybody, to find out more about when the circus is headed to your town, you can head on over to jimrosecircus.com and pick up Jim's latest book. It is Snake Oil, where Jim will reveal all the secrets of the carnies, magicians, psychics, and hustlers. I promise you, it's a fascinating read. You'll never pay for a drink again. Thanks, guys.
Hey, thanks
that was
again,
great.
Kevin.
Let me catch my breath. Now, with the wind beneath my wings, her name is Sarah Lane, and she's here with today's top stories.
Okay, so it's everywhere you are, but never in the way. But what the hell is it? Coasting into week three of Microsoft's Origami Project teaser campaign, here's what we think we know so far. Origami is not a portable Xbox, it's not an iPod killer, and the Halo footage and that demonstration video leaked last week was for demonstration purposes only. Origami is most likely a line of ultra-portable touchscreen media PCs with limited gaming capability. Stay tuned for more info as the March 9th launch date nears. Looking further ahead, Microsoft's European president Neil Holloway promises a faster, more relevant search engine than Google within the next 6 months. He said the new tool would look beyond URLs to find the specific information sought by internet users. ABC will begin offering their hit shows Lost, Desperate Housewives, and Grey's Anatomy online for free. In addition to selling $2 weekly podcasts on iTunes, the network plans to offer free ad-supported downloads of these shows through MyABC at abc.com. However, no official launch date for the service has been set yet. Less is more as far as Japanese gamers are concerned. Gamers waited all night outside Tokyo stores for Nintendo's DS Lite, which went on sale there yesterday. Not only does it sport a slimmer profile and a brighter screen than the original, the DS Lite is voice over IP capable and retails for about $200 US. And finally, remote control sharks could be the newest weapons in the U.S. arsenal. It's true. Scientists from the Defense Advanced Research Project Agency plan to implant electrodes in the brains of blue sharks and release them into the waters off Florida, controlling their movements with an array of sonar towers in the area. The experiment builds on research in which scientists have already successfully controlled the movements of rats, fish, and monkeys. And now, beam directly to the implant in your brain, here are today's headlines. Indiana University's class of 2007 is required to own laptop computers. Yahoo abandons its ambition to produce TV-style content for the web. Barry Bonds to star in a new reality show. One in three people surveyed admit they hurt themselves during sex. Dave Chappelle threatens not to return if Comedy Central airs his lost episodes. And that's today's feed. Chew it thoroughly. Now, stick around. Why? Well, because Cage 9 is fixing to tear it up live in our studio. Plus, the lovely and talented Mila Jovovich is here, also very, very live.
The Feed is brought to you by the U.S. Navy. Navy, accelerate your life.
She has saved the world from total annihilation. She's fought off hordes of flesh-eating creatures. And now she's taking on a ruthless government. In the new sci-fi film, Ultraviolet, I don't think I need to say any more, ladies and gentlemen. Mila Jovovich is here. Mila, how are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Mila, come here. I was,
Thank you.
I was just vacuum packed, so I'm a little frazzled.
I kind of saw the end bit of that, and I was just like,
oh, the part where I was completely out of air and dying?
Kind of, and but you said it was fun. It looks good.
You know, your life flashed before your eyes, and I saw you. And this interview was coming up, and I just had to get out of the bag, because I got to say, you, my friend, are a geek icon. I mean, I don't know if you're aware of this, but between Fifth Element, Resident Evil, and Ultraviolet, you're on the same nerd pedestal as Darth Vader for most people.
Yes.
And is that a big deal? How does that feel to you?
It's awesome. I mean, I have to say I was a big fan of sci-fi and fantasy growing up. So I guess, you know, I was kind of a geek too.
Ah. Now, do you understand, like, what is it about geeks that they like a woman who could totally kick their ass? And why is that?
The geek spurt here.
Yeah, I'm curious because, you know, you are appealing to them. And is it just because the thought that while you're beating them up, you'd actually physically be touching them? Or is there something else going on here?
Well, I don't know. You don't feel excited by thinking about a beautiful woman kind of messing you around.
I like getting roughed up by the ladies every now and then. Don't get me wrong.
Like, but exclusive to geeks, you know?
so it's guys in general. See, that's all I know. That's all I know. Browse my MySpace. It's nothing but geeks. I want to talk about the ultraviolet because I'm driving home from work. Your midriff is not only perfectly sculpted, but it is everywhere. It's everywhere. I'm driving down Venice Boulevard and every billboard and bus shelter, it's just there you are with a sword. And it's added like another 7.5 minutes to my commute. So thank you for that. But that aside, you know, I'm sold.
Thank
just the poster with, the midriff and the sword, I'm sold.
Well,
but I'm...
listen, it wasn't easy, let me tell you. I mean, I had like 7 months of training to get ready for this film. That was before the real training in China started because I like went in to meet the choreographer like 6-7 months before we went to film the movie. And I was so inspired by the team of people that he had prepared for me, and I just started learning things immediately.
Sure.
And they gave me like some sticks to take home and a sword, and I was like practicing for 6 months, and then
I was told
3 months in China, like rehearsing 6 to 8 hour days and stuff.
Right.
But we started the rehearsals way before.
Well, I know that they gave you sticks and a sword, and I was told that you kind of went crazy in the hotel room and trashed it like a rock star. Is that true?
Yeah, you know, I mean, the only thing missing was, like, the parties, you know, but it definitely looked like a rock star's hotel room. I mean, there was light shattered. There was, like, chunks missing out of the ceiling because I do all these, like, I flip swords and stuff, so
sure.
It would just be like, dash, dash, dash. So they weren't very happy with
yeah,
it.
Yeah, Motel
really
6
nice
is never
going to
leave the light on for you anymore.
Who?
The motel chain. But listen, there's a plot to this movie, and this is what.
More about that than I do.
this is a big deal here because, like I said, the poster was fascinating enough, but there's a plot to this movie, and I want to know what it is because you're fighting people, and who are you fighting, and why?
Well, listen, it's actually a really cool story. It's about my character, Violet, who is part of a revolutionary, like, team, you know, of rebels that are trying to bring down this, like, future totalitarian government. And, you know, through it, she meets this kid, and he's very sick, and he's dying, and she has to make a choice with her to, like, complete her mission of bringing down the government,
sure.
Or save the life of this one little boy. So it's you know, it's a cool story.
Wouldn't it have just been more convenient to just take him out with the sword and then get on with the mission, or
take who out?
The little boy. No.
Wait.
I'm just saying.
You told me this was like a nice sort of young people's channel.
Oh yeah,
like,
totally.
What is this about, like, taking out little boys?
Like the tweens don't like the infants. Get rid of them. Now you're doing all the sword trickery, and
he actually taught me how to hack into like computer games. Cameron,
really?
The actor that plays the little boy, he's rad.
He's like teaching you all the Doom cheat codes for God mode.
He's like all these like different words that you type in, and then you get more soldiers or more gold or something.
I love it.
It's really cool.
I love it. Now you brought a clip with you as well, and I want to show it. Do what are we about to see? I'm assuming it involves you kicking some ass.
Yes.
Okay.
It's actually like right at the beginning of the movie. This is Violet's first major fight scene, so it's pretty cool.
All right, pretty intense. Here it is, a scene from Ultraviolet. So apparently a glass does not make the best chest protector, we learn in the future. Maybe they should stick with Kevlar.
No, listen, this is not just glass. It's this special, like, armor of the future, but Violet is so rad that she just breaks through it.
Gotcha.
It's unbreakable.
No match for it. Apparently the camera and the director aren't any match for Violet as well. Everybody was getting hurt
scene,
on this.
No, I destroyed everything. My hotel room. Like, that scene where you see the thing fly off of the gun, that wasn't supposed to happen, but I aimed it really well, so it like hit the camera, right, and broke the camera lens. Then, you know, the director like comes up to me like, oh, let's see what you learned in fight class. Ooh. And he's like, come on, punch me. So I was like, all right, I punched him. It's like, oh, yeah,
please,
whatever,
is that all you got?
Blah, blah, blah. So I punched him again. He's like, yeah, whatever.
Right.
So I just, like, went, bah! You know, and sorry.
No, I felt that the wind, there was wind nothing. I'm easily startled, Mila. That was crazy.
No, I knew what I was doing.
I wasn't
trying to hurt you.
Okay. You want to take a shot, though? Really? We're out of time, but it'd be a great way to end it.
Don't do this to yourself.
I'm not going to.
I'm telling you.
How about I just gingerly shake your hand and thank you for coming on the show? I'm a little... No? Is that right, Mila?
Yes, of course.
Thank you very much
for coming on.
We appreciate it. Everybody, to watch Mila kick some ass and take some names, go see Ultraviolet. It's in theaters everywhere this Friday, and enjoy the billboards while they last. Coming up after the break, I stage dive into a crowd of gangly interns when Cage 9 performs live. So stick around, everybody.
Well, the director of Live Freaky, Die Freaky, a puppet movie about the Manson family. How can that not be awesome? Plus, we give Burnout Revenge just 50 minutes before we pass judgment on it. It's what we call the first 50. And the makeup artist from The Hills Have Eyes shows us that you don't need radiation to make freaky mutants. That's the next Attack of the Show. Now, prepare to get the crap rocked right out of you, because it's Cage 9!
Yeah.
Show.com, and don't forget to run out and pick up their new album, El Motivo, which of course is Spanish for The Motivo. Now, don't go anywhere, because when we come back, it's all emails and chat questions around here.
Number one podcasted network in America.
Wall-to-wall game reviews.
Always expect the unexpected.
Go to iTunes or G4TV.com for details.
You know what, guys? Let's forget the chat. Let's just not and get to the rockin'.
Oh, all right. I'm with you. Brendan, can you dig it?
Let's rock out.
Thanks to our guest, Mila Jovovich, Triumph the Insult Comic Dog, and Jim Rose. Now, one more time, here's Cage 9.
Yeah!
She's gonna wait till the time is right. Frozen in her gaze, the sun is set her place. She's kinda late, she's kinda late, she's kinda late, but she's right on time. Why? 'Cause it's all in vain this time. That scream and vicious circles in her. Bye.